Good evening and welcome to the League of Women Voters program tonight. This November program is a very special one. Tonight we'll be talking about politics, law, and the ethics of immigrant detention in Berks County. And joining us this evening are the Reverend Steve Ohnsman, Richard F. Small, PhD, and Jackie Kline, Esquire. Thank you guys for being here tonight. This is a real hot topic and it's very rooted in Berks County. Tonight we're going to hopefully make some progress on helping everyone in the community understand what's going on in the detention center and what that means for the people that are there and how we can maybe help in some way. So if first let's start, however, by just introducing yourself and telling us a little bit about yourself.
I'm the pastor of Calvary United Church of Christ in Reading, been there about 18 years. Before that, I was a chaplain here at Albright, so I know this area pretty well. And have been involved with this to some extent, probably for about 16 or 17 years.
All right, thank you. Mr. Small?
I've been a practicing psychologist, in Berks County for longer than I care to admit. I was the director of Spring Psychological Associates, which is now part of Springfield Psychological, where I am the site director. I've only been to the immigration center, the detention center, twice, not recently, so I'm not speaking so much out of experience with that particular facility. But I've worked with children, families, adults for many years and hope to lend my expertise to looking at how things may affect child development and family development.
Thank you. And Jackie?
I'm an immigration attorney. My partner and I have a firm in Reading. We also work very closely, so that's Bridget Cambria, myself, at Cambria and Kline, and then with Carolyn Donahoe. The three of us represent the women at the Berks Family Detention Center, and we've represented them for about the past 2 years.
Okay, wonderful, thank you. So just for those that may not know, can you, one of you, explain what is the detention center, how long has it been there, and what's the fuss all about kind of right now?
Well, I mean, you're the most actively involved, I think. Yeah.
So at Berks, it currently houses women and children. There have been some fathers there who are immigrants who are seeking asylum in the United States. They're fleeing tremendous violence. Mostly they're from the Northern Triangle, so Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador. In 2014, immigration's policy started a policy of detaining asylum seekers. Until 2014, Berks was the only family residential center in the entire country. And after that, they built two facilities in Texas that now also house immigrants, families who are fleeing violence. So the women that are there are in the process of fighting to stay in the country, to claim asylum, to protect themselves and their children.
And is that a legal process for them to be in America as asylum seekers?
Yes, so the United States has a policy. For the most part, you have to enter the United States to either approach the border and seek asylum, or you have 1 year after you've entered the United States to apply for asylum. And that process, compared to the amount of people who are coming to seek asylum in the United States, there are very few spaces in these detention centers. There's only a few thousand beds in the detention center. So the majority of people who are coming to the United States are not detained. They're allowed to continue their asylum process outside of the detention centers. And they're monitored by immigration to make sure that they're going through their court process, they're showing up for their hearings, they're doing check-ins. But for the select few who happens to be a bed space open are then placed in these detention centers.
Do you know how those get so lucky to be placed in detention centers?
There's really not any reason why they're chosen. It just is mostly about whether there's a bed space available. There's nothing that's different between them and other people who are approaching the border and seeking asylum. And actually, those who do not come with children are probably less likely to be detained than a person who enters with as a family unit, as immigration refers to them.
Are they typically entering as a family, or maybe not typically, but do they usually have like a father or a husband, and are they split up?
There are times that typically it's one parent and a child who are entering the United States, but there are times that they may have been separated in crossings. So we've had instances where a father and one child crossed and were not detained by, I mean, they were encountered by immigration, but not put into a detention center. Whereas the mother and the other child crossed the next day or the same day and were apprehended and were taken to a detention center. You other also have instances where it may be that the partner who came with the mother is not the child's biological parent. So that father may be taken to a regular immigration detention center while the parent, mother and child are taken to the family residential center.
So the residential center in Berks County is just for women and their children?
There have been men there.
Oh, okay.
The Texas facilities only house women, but the Berks has had men in the past.
Okay.
But the majority is mothers and children.
You know, when our church got involved with this 17 years ago, it was because a member of the church spoke French and was helping them translate. There was a woman and her two small children from the Congo. And I got the feeling when we went, I got brought into it because we helped them find a place to live and helped the family kind of get into a safe place. But I had a feeling that the process was being done for the safety of the kids. That's the feeling I got when it first began. I don't know that that's necessarily the case now anymore, but certainly then I had a feeling that there were they didn't want these women, mostly with their children, not being safe, not having a place that was, and it was a very safe place, but it was also a prison. Mm-hmm. And we, even then, and I know you've said it's changed over time, but even then we saw the living conditions as being almost not quite subhuman, but really not the kind of thing I'd want to see anybody live in. Almost like a kennel, you know, that they were in this room. There wasn't much there. It was fairly stark. They didn't have freedom to go anywhere out of the facility. They were stuck inside all the time. And having that interaction with them was very helpful to the family. But this is a woman who had a 4-month-old and a 4-year-old. You know, she was stuck. So it may have been for the best intentions. I'm not sure that's still the case.
Mm-hmm. And can you recall how long she was in there?
I got involved. She had been there, recollection is hard, it's a long time ago, but probably a couple months, maybe 2 months by the time I got involved. She was in there a little bit long, maybe another month or two. Her husband had been separated from the family and presumed dead in the Congo, and it was Africa at that point was a very dangerous place, still is. And so I think that they made their way here, the three of them. Remarkable story about this woman and a 4-month-old and a 4-year-old making it from the Congo to this country. It was remarkable, but she had no family here. She had really nobody, and this was the safest place to be. Mm-hmm. But it was a long time.
So from what I understand, and you can probably speak to this better, the women and children that are currently in there have been there longer than 4 months.
Right.
And the past few years, it seems to be continuing that trend.
Right. So prior to 2014, the majority of women who were only there for short periods of time. In cases, it may have been different where they had no family. So the majority of people who enter have some relation in the United States. And typically they're released to that relative. So they may have been housed at Berks for the short time while immigration was attempting to locate that family to make sure that that family really was their family and they weren't going to a trafficker or. And then people who really had no family in the United States at all may have stayed at Berks for a longer term. And in the past few years, I mean, we have had families who really had no one in the United States. Mm-hmm. And in that instance, we were able to get them. They were at Berks, but we were able to find churches to sponsor them with other programs that they were to get into. So up until 2014, the average stay was very short. It was only a few months. But in 2014 is when we saw immigration's policy change. And at the outset in 2014, their stated policy was they wanted to send a message to women and children in Guatemala, in Honduras, and El Salvador not to come to the United States. And so they put women and children into detention centers to send a message to people in their countries, don't come here because you're not going to get the protection that you think you are. Obviously, that's not illegal. I mean, they're not allowed to do that. And so they sort of backed away from using the term deterrence, but nothing in their policy has changed. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's still as a deterrence method, they're just not using the word deterrence. And so starting in 2014 is when we started to see very long detention times. The first set of women that were at Berks were there for over a year. They released all of them in July of 2015, and they immediately filled it up again. And those women that came after that time are still, the majority of them are still detained there.
So more than a year.
Yes. There are some approaching 14 months, I think.
And you've been to this facility, visited it numerous times?
Yes. We're there in the facility multiple times a week. If not myself, one of our staff members is there almost on a daily basis for the past 2.5 years.
And can you tell the viewers what it's like in the facility?
And as the Reverend said, it's a very stark environment. They are not allowed to, I mean, it's a very small space. They have rooms upstairs, then they have the visitation rooms, the attorney rooms. There is sort of a gym. I mean, it has some mats and other exercise equipment. There is an outdoor space, but they're not free to come and go. They can only be outside if they're called shelter care counselors. We refer to them as guards because that's what their job essentially is to guard the women and make sure that they don't leave or they're not. But they're not allowed to go outside without that person. They can't leave the grounds. There are times when they can't be in the downstairs part of the facility. They have to, you know, after 8 o'clock, they have to be upstairs in where the bedrooms are. So it's a place that's, I mean, any place, no matter how nice of an environment it is, if you're there for a year and you're not able to leave and everything about your day is controlled, the time you get up is controlled, the time that you go to bed is controlled, the food that you eat is controlled, when you can go outside, when you can't, you know, all of those things are very, make it a very difficult, you know, environment to be in.
And what is, oh, wonderful. We have a home viewer. It's a question. By the way, we are absolutely accepting questions from home viewers, so please do call in at 610-378-0426 if you have a question. But go ahead with that question, home viewer.
Thank you. I think this is such an interesting show, and you have great guests. I wanted to find out how the detention center is supposed to work, what and why it's not working that way now, and who also oversees this. I'm assuming it's federal, but there's so many problems, I assume, but I'd like to find out what is ideally supposed to happen that is not happening and who is running this. Thank you.
Well, the facility is, it's a contract between the County of Berks and Immigration and Customs Enforcement, or ICE. So ICE determines who is at the facility, but the staff, our county staff, the facility is a county facility. So some parts of it are what immigration's and the federal policies are, and the other parts of it is what, you know, the county continues to maintain the contract with ICE to run the facility.
It seems like I was doing some reading about this, and it seems like it's a pretty expensive way to deal with a problem. I mean, everybody wants people vetted. Everyone wants to make sure that when you're coming into this country, you're not here for negative meaning. We want that, and I think that's part of the importance of these programs. It's certainly happening with refugees from all over the world. But once you've done that, especially after a couple of months of being in a prison, basically, it's a prison. There are ways that you can allow a person to live humanely, and also save money, and I'm not sure that that's the goal in this.
And it costs taxpayers about $300 a day per person to house them at these detention centers. So the majority of women who are entering the United States, they are not put into detention centers. They're released to their family, and it's at their family's expense to house them, to care for them during the time that they're in the court process. But immigration is monitoring them. I mean, it's not as if they enter the United States and suddenly disappear into, you know, America somewhere. Many of them, not that I necessarily agree with it, but many of them are put onto ankle monitors, so immigration knows where they are. They have to physically check in at an immigration building periodically. They're called on the phone at a home phone at a specific day and time. So immigration has many ways that they're monitoring people who are going through the process that is not, as you said, that's a more humane process, that is a less expensive process to taxpayers. And I think that's sort of the issue that we as practitioners have with family detention centers, is that there are humane ways to do it, and family detention is not a humane way to treat asylum seekers and refugees coming to the United States.
So, as was previously stated, there are three in the entire country. Mm-hmm. Two of them, of the detention centers, are in Texas. Do you know why, or does anyone know why, that there's one here in Pennsylvania and two in... How did that happen? Why aren't there more centers all over the country? And maybe...
I mean, I don't know. Like I said, prior to 2014, Berks was the only family detention center in the entire country.
Okay.
And like I said, it was operating for people, I mean, for the protection of people who have no family in the United States, you know, in order to make sure that they had a place. But once immigration changed their policy and started to detain and not release those families, I'm not sure why Texas necessarily was chosen, other than, I mean, it's closer to the border. I don't know specifically why they chose that, but... Mm-hmm.
Who is actually running this facility? Do you know?
The Texas or
The Berks? The Berks County one.
The Berks County facility is run by the county of Berks. The two in Texas are run by the private prison corporations,
okay.
Where Berks is the only county run facility.
Interesting. All right, well, it looks like we have another home viewer. Go ahead with your question.
Hi, how are you? I have a question that just kind of arose in my mind the last couple of days. I don't know why, it never did before. But the people who leave their countries to come here, whether they're from south of the border or from Russia, which has a lot of illegal aliens in this country, in like the New York City, Brooklyn area, or whether they're coming here from Asia, do their home countries know that they've left? And if they know that, do they make any effort to recall them, to get them back? I just can't imagine Americans just leaving Sinking Spring, a whole family, and just disappearing without the local authorities or whomever not concerned about where did the Taylor family go, and making an effort to find out where the Taylors are.
Hello?
Yeah. Did you hear my question?
Yeah.
We sure did. BCTV provides our community
the family
with access
we were helping
to a wide array of...
was kind of fits into this question. The husband was a journalist, and he was very critical of the Congo government, and so they were in the midst of revolution, and they were about to kill him, and so he and his family, they found back channels to get out of the country, but he got separated from them, and the story is so long, and I won't tell it, but he ended up going through something like six different countries, and finally finding his way 3 years later, but they were escaping because they're going to die. And I think that's what's happening in a lot of these countries, is we think, well, these illegal, you know, they're illegal immigrants and they're coming into this country to steal our jobs, which isn't true. They're trying to live. And I think there are some cases that isn't true, obviously, but for us, we don't have that kind of experience in our life. Most of us can make a better life for ourselves. We have some freedoms that can't be taken away. Most of the world isn't like that.
Most of the world isn't quite like Sinking Spring.
Right, right.
Trying to get away from it. Yeah. Well, we do have another home viewer, so go ahead with your question.
Yeah, thanks for taking my call. Listen, I have a question about the immigration and about what you were talking about. Listen, are these people, are they part of the Berks County prison system? Are they housed at Berks County prison? Are they housed in another section and the correction officers kind of take turns, and let's say a correction officer may be up at Berks County prison, he's up at Berks County prison, but then his boss will say, okay, now why don't you over to the detention center and split shifts. Do they do it that way, or what's happening there?
Well, it's not part of the correctional facility. It's a separate facility which is run between Immigration and Customs Enforcement, ICE, and the County of Berks. It's across the street from the prison, but they're not in the same facility as the prison. In other detention centers, not family detention centers, such as the York Detention Center, immigrants who are housed in the prison with other criminals that have been arrested. So many immigration prisons across the United States are part or are housed inside of prisons. This one is separate as a family detention center.
And do correction officers from Berks County Prison, do they go over there and babysit, or babysit? Well, that's what they really do, babysit. But or do they have their own, or does the is this federal? Do they have their own? Do they have their own guards, etc.?
Right. Well, the people who are sort of acting as guards or overseeing the women are Berks County employees. There are immigration officers who are in the facility, but the day-to-day operation of the facility is done by county employees. They're not called guards. They have different names, but that's essentially their job.
Okay, very good. Well, thank you very much for taking my call, and good show, and good information, everybody, and have a happy Thanksgiving, everybody, okay?
Thank you.
Thanks, you too.
Okay, have a good day. Thank you. Thanks.
All right. Well, I have another question. I know there's been some information in the newspaper about there's a lot of controversy over this and what's been happening with the level of non-care happening with the mm-hmm. women and children, and possibly about passing legislation to change the way this is working. Mm-hmm. Can you speak to that?
I mean, there are there are a lot of issues that we see with detaining moms and children. I mean, these are women and children, or fathers and children, who are coming from extremely violent countries. They have a lot of trauma, and you're putting them in a situation that is re-traumatizing. For the most part, they've all experienced, whether it's domestic violence, it's violence from the gangs, some type of threat, and you know, fear of their life. That's why they're here in the United States. So when you're in a situation at the detention center, I mean, there's a lot of medical issues that we see that we don't feel are being treated properly. The level of psychiatric care, you know, is something that we don't feel is adequate for the type of trauma that's going on. There's not a specific psychologist who's trained in child care or child trauma, or even for the mothers, I mean, who are coming from very violent experiences, and it's to be put in prison. You know, you're fleeing your life and you're here seeking help, and you're put in a prison. I mean, it's very re-traumatizing to them, and that's something that we as practitioners see as a problem with how family detention is run, when you're taking sort of the most vulnerable populations and re-traumatizing them, mm-hmm. you know, over and over again by not releasing them and not allowing them to get the treatment that they need in other, you know, whether that would, if they were with their families, they'd be able to get that in other ways.
Mm-hmm. Well, the League of Women Voters did reach out to the county commissioners to come and speak tonight, and they were unable to make it. So I guess one of my questions is, I think they have some say as to how this is working. Mm-hmm. Is that correct?
Yes.
And there's been an appeal, and they have, but it's been, I'm not exactly sure how to say this, it's been backburnered for months. Is that correct?
Right. So the state of Pennsylvania, who licensed the facility, non-renewed the license because What they were licensed under was as a child care facility, and they're housing mothers and children together. And so the state renewed that, and the county appealed that decision. And so that is still going through the court process.
Okay. All righty. Well, this is such a hot topic. We have another home viewer, so go ahead with your question.
Hi. Am I on?
Yes, you are.
Okay. It doesn't sound like many people in Berks County grasp that every human on earth, according to international law, has a right to seek asylum if they're persecuted for a number of reasons. And the people who come here seeking asylum have come to us for help, mm-hmm. for safety. And so often they have been abused by people in authority, mm-hmm. and they're now detained by people in uniforms. And children, the parents try very hard to protect their children from the reality that they're in prison. I remember one little four-year-old grabbing her mother's face and saying, if I'm not in prison, I'm walking through that door. And then when someone is granted asylum, we say, you did the right thing in coming to us. Welcome to America. But in the meantime, we have a situation where this long detention is violating human rights, mm-hmm. and the Berks County commissioners keep us complicit in it. And, the child comes to you for help because they're being abused, and you lock him in your basement and say, oh, but it's all right because I don't have the key. Someone else has the key. Mm-hmm. We are participating in the violation of their human rights, and it's very distressing. Can you suggest any way that we can get the county commissioners to grasp that many reports have been written about the Berks facility and its human rights violations, and perhaps they could get out of the business of making money off of asylees?
Thank you for your question. Before you answer, mm-hmm. I will bring up that in a Reading Eagle article, it says that ICE, which we talked about earlier, mm-hmm. reimburses the county and pays more than $1 million every year for using the building. So there is money being made mm-hmm. on this. So would you like to, what could people do?
I know there's a lot of people in the county who do care, but I think there's also a lot of people who still aren't really aware of the issue that's going on. And raising awareness and continuing to voice our concern and our distress over this issue, I think, is important. I know that we can't necessarily change the federal policy of family detention, but the county can choose to not be a part of that by not renewing their contract and to not sort of further the human rights violations of family detention. And that's something that, I as a practitioner fighting to end family detention in general and with the federal policy, but also, I live in Berks County and I don't want to see my taxpayer dollars go to furthering human rights violations, to furthering the trauma of people who, the women that I represent, I listen to them tell me every day the most horrible things that can happen to a person. And to hear their stories and their strength, I don't know that I would be that courageous to leave a country, to walk for months with my little child through the really dangerous situations, because I know that being in my country means death. And it means that they're going to die and I'm going to die. And then we come here and, America says, we're going to put you in this detention center, for however long that takes. If that's a year of your life, so be it. And I think that's a really, as an American, as a, citizen of and resident of Berks County, I don't want to be a part of that. So
I'd like to focus on something mm-hmm. you said about a year in somebody's life. And I think one of the focuses I'd want to look at is the children and the children's development. I think a lot of times we talk about the women and the families in focus mm-hmm. for good reason, because they've been very traumatized and the kids are kind of following with them. And my concern, and I want to do a shout out for our county, because I think we do a lot of good things in our county. I do work with Children's Services, and I know there's a huge number of very dedicated people who are trying to help and protect the children in our county. In looking at when you say, oh, well, it's a year of their lives, a year in a child's life is not only a bigger proportion of their life, but it really hinders their development. And somebody might say, one of you said a prison, it's still a prison, nice or not very nice. Mm-hmm. And you might say, oh, they were in a gang-infested place in Honduras or something like that, and gee, this must be much better. But kids in that environment are at least growing, and I'm not saying it's a good environment, and I'm not in any way trying to say that, but being in a confined space in sort of a barren, sterile kind of environment with limited interaction with the environment, with others, can really hurt kids' development. And they're already, you know, you talk about these women being in a foreign place. These kids, it's even more foreign in that sense. And that's a big concern that I have, is, keeping these kids or mothers and kids there for this extended period of time and what that does for their development.
Yes. You know, there's also an ethical dimension to this that we struggle with in a lot of ways in this country. Fracking. It's economically good in some ways, but it destroys the environment. There's jobs versus caring for certain safety. There's a lot of things that we're going to be struggling with and have been for a long time. And I think it's the same thing. I think when we talked before the show started, the idea that this is similar to, in some ways, the kids for cash thing that we lived through in this state. There's a lot of money involved here. And I don't know that it started out that way, that it was for the money, but in some ways you look at that, you look at, well, the arrogance of saying at least they're safe there. You know, it's better than, like, it's better than the drugs that they were around or the gangs that they were around before. They should be grateful. I mean, I think there's some of that that goes on. Well, that's just not, the ethical question there is that, no, that's not the right answer. Mm-hmm. If they're here for asylum, and I know the religious community in this has been protesting quite a bit about this and showing up and trying to say this is not the way you treat people, mm-hmm. No matter where they're from. And especially the most defenseless, and that's women and with their small children. I think that's the ethical question that has to be asked in this process.
I don't know if we've gotten to this, but how many women and children are there in the facility?
The facility can house 96. It's sort of an ever-changing number. There is a large majority of the women have been there for over a year, but there are some spaces that people are released and mm-hmm. are filled again.
96 total?
Beds, yeah. Okay. I'm not sure the exact
number. How many children are there, approximately?
It's roughly about half. It's usually one parent, one child. There are a few that have several kids.
I'm sorry I keep asking you all these questions because you've been there.
Yeah.
But what are they doing for the children on a daily basis? Anything? Is there any education? Is there any play? Is there, mm-hmm. what do they get to do?
I mean, there is school classes, but it's what I would sort of liken to like one room schoolhouses. So there's a class for the younger age and there's a class for the older age. And you see, as you're talking about developmental things, I mean, you have some kids that are teenagers and are older and find that the curriculum isn't challenging to them and they're bored and they don't, sort mm-hmm. of, they're not getting, and you detain them for a year, you know, it's very hard to catch up on that. Also, you have very young children that there have been kids who probably needed special needs classes mm-hmm. or other types of assistance, which they're not, you know, sort of able to get where they might be getting that if they were in the school system. Mm-hmm. I mean, they have, like I said, an outdoor areas. They have...
But they're not allowed to leave. Ever.
I mean, they do take them on trips. They might take them to the mall, or they take them to a festival. So there are some trips that they take off of the facility, but I mean, the majority of their day and their life is spent, you know, mm-hmm. inside the facility or in that yard.
That sounds like an educational nightmare. I know that anybody who works with special ed, special needs kids, and in the schools that are better equipped, and people might argue about how equipped they are, when you just get even kids, I think it's still called ESL, English as a Second Language, is already a challenge. If you have kids with special needs, well, these kids have been traumatized. These kids have been, you know, maybe walked with their mothers for, you know, whatever it is. There may be bandits. They may have been, I would think that every one of these kids in their own way is a special needs child. And unless there's educational programming that is really, really individualized, and I don't know exactly what it is, but I'd be very concerned about that.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. We do have another home viewer, so please go ahead with your question.
I would like to thank all the panelists. It's a lot of good information. But I understand that Dr. Small has been a helpful consultant to the field of psychology, and he has advised psychologists who were on a pro bono basis went in to evaluate people who were in extreme need, primarily women, I believe. And then an evaluation took place, and in a couple cases, the people were removed from the facility. So I was just wondering if he might be able to address that asylum kind of interview. Thank you.
I always get a little scared when somebody says, Dr. Small has, I want to hide. I have been involved, and it's been a little while, when people have appealed for asylum, there have been a number of cases where I've had to assess whether there is psychological damage or a psychological threat or trauma. I'm not a detective fact finder to find out what happened or whether there were gangs, but there have been a number of incidences where I have been involved in doing an evaluation that was part of either, from what I recall, more where people have, it's been part of a process of applying for asylum.
Thank you for your, thank you for your question. Thank you for your answer.
Okay.
Glad it wasn't too bad. I have a question regarding the women and children. What light at the end of the tunnel might they have? Do they get any information as to when they might be getting out? Or is it just tomorrow you're out, you're gone? How does that work?
The set of women who are there right now, who have been detained the longest, are sort of in a more difficult legal procedural posture. Mm-hmm. So they're not going through the straight asylum process because they're alleging that deficiencies happened at the border interview, at their asylum interviews, that prevented them from sort of getting into that process. And the majority of them are appealing. There's a federal case that they're part of to sort of challenge that. But typically, I mean, even if they're going through the normal process, it's not something that, we can really tell them as attorneys when this is going to happen, or that certainly immigration doesn't tell them, you know, really when they're going to be released. So for them, I mean, you're sort of in a situation, in an unknown situation. You don't know how long you're going to be there. You don't know what the process is like. When you're talking about for the children especially, I mean, we see a lot of children who are regressing. I mean, 8-year-olds who are wetting their bed again. You have 6, 7, and 8-year-olds who are suicidal, and not only voicing that, but have told us, like, this is how I plan to carry that out. And I mean, I'm not a psychologist, but I don't think that that's a normal thing for a child that young to be contemplating. I mean, and there's often a real sense of hopelessness, I mean, not just for the mothers, but for the children. I know and when we first started going there, often when they were released, we were the ones who picked them up from the facility and would take them to the bus station or to be released to their families. And so a lot of the children saw us as not just the lawyers, but the people who got them out. And so when we would come and want to meet with the moms, they wanted to be there because they thought that we were taking them with us. I mean, and that was really difficult to, every time we leave, you know, have the child crying because I'm not able to take them out with me, you know, and it's very difficult to explain to a small child why they have to be there that long and the process. I mean, it's a difficult process, legal process, to explain to adults, let alone, you know, a child. And I think that sort of, it makes the child hopeless, it makes the parent hopeless, and, you know, what affects the child affects the parent. And it's just sort of a bad cycle that that just makes sort of the emotional and psychological impact so much worse, you know, to be detained for these periods of time.
A couple of things that you said there I think are very important. Number one, I would agree that it's rare, quite rare, to see kids that age suicidal. I mean, they might say, I want to kill myself, not even knowing what it means, mm-hmm. but for them to be talking that way is very, very rare. Mm-hmm. I think there's two other factors that you mentioned. One of them is the uncertainty that is, uncertainty makes things very, very difficult. I mean, we know that about medical procedures. You know, if you're told, oh, we don't know, and everybody's kind of mysterious, it's so much worse than if you're told, okay, here's your diagnosis, here's your prognosis, even if it isn't good. So you deal with that. And then the other thing you mentioned is the hopelessness that when parents feel hopeless, I mean, there's a lot of research that says very depressed parents, who part of depression is helplessness and hopelessness, that is a very toxic environment to grow up in. So here you have some kids who the only one they have is their mother, and she's hopeless, she's going through all that. I mean, it's the kind of situation that I would want to see alleviated as soon as possible. I think it is really a psychologically very harmful mm-hmm. situation for these kids.
And it's counterintuitive in a sense that you have these folks here, you're not going to send them back, right? If they're here, you probably aren't going to send them. So they're going to be, you want to create citizens, good citizens. And yet, you give to them this source of abuse that then they're not going to turn around and be thankful or be happy or, you know, contribute. They're going to become, it's very possible they could become a danger to themselves, to others. I mean, this kind of, it doesn't make sense to mistreat somebody when the final outcome is going to be that they're going to be part of your country.
Do most of them end up being able to stay?
I mean, of the first set of women that we had who were detained a year, I would say probably 90% of them won asylum, were able to stay in the U.S. Only a very small percentage of them were deported, and the majority, I mean, those women chose to take deportation because they couldn't stand being detained mm-hmm. for that period of time. But right. We were very successful in winning their cases, which just sort of goes to, you know, to our point that these are refugees and these are women and children who can seek asylum in the U.S. and who are granted asylum. And so you're taking, you know, people who meet the definition of refugees, and I mean, it's demonstrated they've won those cases, and you said you're traumatizing them for this year, and then when they win and they're released, I mean, we have kids who were detained for a year who don't want to go to school because the school building reminds them of Berks, right. And they're afraid that if they go inside the school, they're never coming out again. And how do you, as a mom, explain to your child, well, this is a different situation, you know, this school is okay, right. But where were you, you know? And so I think it's what you're saying, I mean, it rings true for me in our experiences, is that the kids who are released still continue to suffer, yeah. impacts from being detained for
and let me just say, I think that what follows beyond that is if you've got 18 or 19 years of history, and over that time 90% of these folks have been granted asylum, so you know that if they're going to be here, it seems to me that to continue this sort of thing, which is dehumanizing, mm-hmm. which is financially inappropriate, mm-hmm. Tells me that it's not being done for their benefit. It's being done for financial reasons. I mean, I just can't, thinking about it and reading about it and seeing what happens to these families, it's not like, oh, they might, or half of them might go back, so we have to really vet them so much more carefully. It seems that this process is demeaning and also making someone wealthy. I can't see any other possibility is why something like this continues.
Well, $1 million is a good chunk of change to be bringing into the county.
Yes.
Albeit wrongly. So you do keep in touch with some of the ones who have been granted asylum. Mm-hmm. And I'm guessing none of them stayed in Berks County.
I mean, some of them were in Philadelphia, but the majority of them had family that were in other parts of the country, and mm-hmm. so that's where, when they were released, they went to live with them.
Well, I think we can all share a debt of gratitude to you and to your firm for doing this pro bono work for these yeah. women and children.
Thank you.
It's amazing. I think to sort of, not to wrap it up yet, we have another home viewer. All right, go ahead. Home viewer, go ahead with your question.
Well, oh dear, it's Margaret again. They did such a good job. But Jackie Kline,
yes.
Could you tell us why the children cannot get out? Because I understand the BCI goes in and the Berks County Children's Services go in and have to follow the law to protect children. So could you tell us why the children can't leave for school?
I don't know, I mean, why they aren't able to go to school outside of the facility. And that's something that a lot of the children have been asking to do. I mean, I'm not sure sort of between ICE and the county, and a lot of, not just with the school, but a lot of the things that we find is ICE blames the county and says, well, that's not our policy, that's the county. The county says it's a state. The state says it's the county. The county says it's ICE. You know, and there's this very circular passing of blame between everyone for a variety of different issues, not just the school issue. But, I mean, the county says because ICE says that they're housed there, you know, that's where they have to remain until immigration determines that they are free to leave.
Thank you for your question. Thank you for the answer. I think one of the questions that everyone watching will have is, what can we do? What can we do to help? What can we do to end this? How can we help you? How can we help the people that are there? What can we do, if anything? Write the commissioners? I mean, I think that's the simplest,
right.
most obvious answer, but what else could the community do?
I mean, I think it's sort of a two-part. I mean, obviously, you want to let the county commissioners know and the county know that we're not happy with what's going on here, and also continuing to let the federal government know we're not happy with family detention, sort of both of those things in conjunction.
And does your firm need help?
Yes. We can always use the help.
Yeah?
Yes.
Christmas is coming.
Christmas is coming.
So that's something we could do, at least that, to help right. with. We were talking earlier outside about your firm and how perhaps personally you guys give a lot of your money, your time,
right.
Not just the firm, but so... That's good to know as well. And also the different churches mm-hmm. in the community have been reaching out and mm-hmm. and visiting the
right.
the detention center.
That's right, yeah. Some of the congregations have really taken this mm-hmm. this on as part of their mission. And I would say what you can do is that my experience with politicians is that if one person speaks to them or calls them, they believe that there's probably 10 others who agree. And we were told that if somebody in a position, if a member of the clergy or somebody who's involved in some way, that there's more people who might agree. And the more you speak, the more they might understand that this is an issue that more than just a few people care about. That's how you get things changed. But you have to be loud about it because there's other things at play.
Mm-hmm. That's very good information. Well, does anybody have anything else to say?
Are they collecting any kind of holiday gifts? I know that is not the answer mm-hmm. to everything, but the holidays would seem pretty dreary.
I know what they have in the past. I'm not sure if that's in the works now, but I mean, we can certainly, if we hear of that, you know, let people know.
Mm-hmm. Great. Well, thank you guys for being here. It's a very solemn topic, and I really appreciate, as well as the whole community, all the information that's been given tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Goodbye.